That's how we like to start our shows, Danbert.
Hiya!
You know, I'm not sure if you can even hear the music in Zoom. I know, but trust me when I say it's... it's alright. What's happening, everybody in all the chat rooms? Of course. Well, let's double check. K28, of course. Literally less than 1 minute. We got the first chat in. Russ Bailey coming in at a close second. Cat slacking a little bit. I saw you try the other day. And, hey, what's happening, Brad? Wait, why am I talking to you in the chat room? You're on the show. Okay, we'll get to you in a second, Brad. Don't worry, buddy. Now, let's go ahead and say what's up to everybody else in the Discord chat. Nah. Hi. How about that? We'll just say hi. There you go. And, I'm just kidding. Tim, Apple... these are all, am I the right thing? Anyway, it doesn't matter. Ladies and gentlemen, Danbert Nobacon from Chumbawamba. Yeah, think about that. So, yes, I've been promoting this for the last 2 or 3 or 4 weeks. And I know a lot of you, especially Americans, you're like, oh, yeah, that's... Yeah, I remember... Yeah. Well, here's the thing, though, folks. In much of the rest of the world, they were killing it for 30 years. And in some of that story is what we're going to get about. And obviously, because Danbert Nobacon was not only commonly referred to as, you know, one of the front men, but also multi-instrumentalist, not only in that project, but also in several of the projects he's done afterwards. but we're, there's so much to get into tonight, and so much so that we're going to cut this intro very short. But before we do, I might as well introduce, a couple of people. I forgot about all the people. Hey, what's happening? Brad, our associate producer, you can follow him on Twitter at @ADSBradHarris. How are you? That's a cue, Bradley.
He's on mute.
He is. Well, guess who's not on mute?
Oh, goodness gracious, I'm not on mute. It was a stylish pause, you know. You want to be a little bit late to the party, so they're waiting for you, right?
Yeah.
Anyhow, ahoy there! Welcome ashore, everybody. It's going to be a great show. So stoked, man. We got a one and only Mr. Nobacon coming in hot. And, yeah, man, I can't wait to ask a couple of questions myself. And looking at the chat room, everything's looking hot right now. It's firing. So, yeah, guys, let's jump in.
Oh, and speaking of that, okay, I'm not sure how else to say this, folks. So we've been giving out T-shirts over the last few weeks, as you know. Let's see. We've got Salsalito, Sarah, Christy, Elfman, and several. Scott, you're getting one. Jimmy Church got one for some reason. Not sure if that was the best use of that shirt. But either way, here's the thing, though. Sarah, God bless you. In fact, you were the first person to ever ask for a shirt, and for some reason, your emails aren't getting to me, and my emails aren't getting to you. But I just texted you on Twitter, and if you can see that text, just respond with your shirt information, the size, and we will get that to you. And for all the other shirt winners, you should be getting those next week. But, you know, with everything going on, sometimes things take too slow and all that good fun stuff. Now, real quick, in just a few minutes, because I really do want to get Danbert from Chumbawamba on here, and I really want to get into all that. But real quick, Brad, you went out to Disclosure Fest last week. How was that?
Man, it was an experience. We went to a cool. What it was a school for like children that had been through traumatic times and homeless kids. And it was kind of, it's something I've never experienced, man. It was beautiful. So what they did is they took like this old school, somebody bought it and turned it into, you know, dorms and just a full-on living, learning kind of situation, totally positive vibes, a lot of art going on. Of course, they had music, they had a studio room, they had an art room. And I was just like, man, right in the middle of Watts, downtown LA, man, it was pretty beautiful. And so what they did is they took the library and they set up pretty much a little on-site set to film the intros for Disclosure Fest. Thus, they filmed the actual guests at the historic park weeks prior. So it was neat. Like, they had each presentation was outside and this and that, but it was definitely a virtual online computer gig. But, you know, hats off to Adrian Vieira for making it happen. He didn't put his foot off the gas at all. No matter what, he made it happen, even though it had to get pushed to a virtual thing. The last 3 years he's been doing it, it's been a free event. Five stages, 22,000 people, you know, at the last event, just all vegan, just very good vibes, good music, good people. Great place to network and find friends and just vibe with the same people that have the same like minds. And just a lot of different things too that you've never seen, you know, different arts and whatnot. So, yeah, his virtual event, you can check it out at disclosurefest.org. And there's a marketplace there. You can still order things and help support what Adrian does. And that's feeding the kids and planting trees and cleaning beaches and doing all the things that we wish we had time to do. So, you know, if you can't do it, maybe you can help support him in some way or another. So check it out, you guys.
There you go. There you go. And, of course, Pat coming in swinging strong with some jokes coming in here. And you know what? I don't want to wait. Like I said, I don't want to waste any more time because, ladies and gentlemen, we have Danbert Nobacon from Chumbawamba. Now, like I was telling you before, Danbert, for most Americans, like, yeah, we remember Chumbawamba. 97, hey. 98, like, oh my God, that song was
every
playing.
Every party I went to, there was a song bumping in the back. Come on.
You know, that song was playing, and that was fantastic for you guys. But what I really, here's how I really want to start the show, though, is I want to go back all the way to the beginning. I'm talking about the early 80s, because especially, you know, American one-hit wonder, that's all they knew, people. They don't know what you guys were actually like really doing. And there's so many great examples from the money you took from General Motors and you know what, we'll save that story for later too. But so here's a fun fact though, before I start let you talking, Danbert, is so I mean you're the whole Chumbawamba crew kind of a, you know, that was early mid 80s. But what a lot of people don't know though is that the very first record that came out from your whole, I wouldn't even call it a group, it's more of a I don't want to say
arrangement,
just a great family you guys were. But anyway, what I'm trying to get at, if you really want to look into it, you started the whole thing, didn't you?
Well, I wouldn't go that far, but we, you know, we had a high school band and that kind of had a natural lifespan of about 18 months and then went off to college and realized all we ever did was go see bands and want to be in a band again. So in like probably late 1981, three of us were in college together in Leeds in England, and we just started doing songs again, and that was the beginning of Chumbawamba. And our first show was in January 1982.
Ah, oh, see, that's what I
And then,
thought.
it was like another, we didn't put an EP out. I don't, we put cassettes out. We
Right.
didn't put an EP out till 1985. And that kind of was the, that kind of put us on the map, if you will. And,
Were y'all like selling cassettes out of just to anybody you could, kind of thing?
yeah,
Or
like at shows and mail order, and before the internet, before cell phones, so it was like snail mail. People, you put your address on there and people would order the cassette and we'd send them out. We all lived in the same house at that time. So we'd
right.
like, right, oh shit, we got to do these orders. So we'd sit down for a few hours and
Yeah,
write
we got to pay the rent, so we
it.
got to sell some of these tapes.
But we were squatting at the time. We squatted for 6 years.
And
So
that's exactly
squatted for 6 years. Wow.
what I want to get to, Danbert, because I don't think any of our American listeners, and by American listeners, I mean a vast majority of them, they don't realize that. Oh no, oh no. Here we go. Well, anyway, I forgot what I was saying. But anyway, just kind of back to the point. As Americans looking like, okay, we turn on MTV, we see that Chumbo, and don't get me wrong, Chumbawamba is a fantastic song. And also Amnesia did pretty good as well, right? But that's
You mean Tum Thumper,
It's
Brian?
almost
Or Gigi said?
Amnesia is one of the songs on Tum Thumper. So it's almost unfair that we just simply weren't exposed to what you guys were really all about and how you functioned. Everything from splitting everything down the middle. Everything from you like and here's kind of the main point. Think of your punk bands back in the 80s, back in the especially back when you guys were around, and their whole thing is like, oh, you can't sell out, right? Well, guess what you guys did? Not only like, yeah, you took a deal, but guess what you and your again, I'm talking about the General Motors deal. Which, for those of you that don't know, you guys, correct me if I'm wrong. Why don't you tell the story?
Okay, so like I said, we were like, total in the 80s, we were total underground and we all had other jobs and went to school and basically, and we started putting albums out and they'd kind of break even so we'd have enough money to put the next album out. And we basically decided in, I guess, so 10 years, yeah, 1992, right? We got to do this proper. And it was when I turned 30. We got to do this properly or give up. So we decided we all give up our jobs and we got an agent and we were doing like 120 shows a year, mostly around Europe. And still, making albums, and it was the era of MTV, so we were making music videos, and basically, like I said, we went through every stage from putting out, DIY cassettes to EPs and albums on a small independent distribute, our own label, and then a smaller indie label, and then a bigger independent label, and it, having been like a full-time professional touring band for 5 years, which is when the Tub Thumper album happened. We were recording that album with One Little Indian Records, big independent label in Britain, and they were, unbeknown to us, they had severe financial problems and were about to let us go. But we actually walked before they let us go. But they would have sacked us. They sacked half the bands and half the workers to stay above water, And so we finished that album with our own money. And so we have this finished album, and our management are passing it around. And suddenly we're getting like offers from major labels, which to us was like insane. Why are they even interested? And interestingly, none of the British offices of those labels wanted to touch us at all. And it was the German label, EMI and Universal in America. And, you know, we always operated as a collective, and we had like long band meetings. There's no way we can do this. It's selling out. It's selling out. And then eventually we just thought, well, look, this is a really interesting opportunity. Let's do it. We'll probably have a real good laugh for a year, and then they'll dump us. And basically it lasted 3 years before they dumped us, but they did. And we, you know, during that time, we kind of burnt all our bridges. So the thing with General Motors was, you know, we were on tour where we had Tub Thumping, the big song was taking off around Europe and America. And we started getting faxes. It was even in like 97, it was still fax machines. So we're in a venue in Italy, and a fax comes through, and it's, oh, Fiat, they want to use the song in an advert. We're like, no way. And then somebody says, well, what if you take the money and give it away? So we're like, okay.
Yes.
So we were playing this big old squat in Milan, and we'd played there, you know, over the years. And they had this pirate radio station there, and they said, so we said to them, we were doing an interview with them as part, you know, before the gig. And we said, look, you know, if we gave you like $20,000 and it's coming from Fiat, would you accept it? And they're like, yeah, that'll keep us going for like 10 years. So we did it, and we did a few, and General Motors was the biggest one. And we gave the money to Indie Media and an anti-General Motors campaign group. And it's kind of,
that's so funny.
You never hear about bands doing it. And it's actually really difficult to do it because you have to have that money in the bank. You know, you put out a statement saying we're giving this money to Indie Media. So you got to give it to Indie Media, you know, and of course we want to give it to Indie Media, but our like royalty monies are like a year behind. So it's kind of a balancing act, but we did it for maybe, I don't know, a couple of years. We managed to give huge chunks of money away. I mean, we'd always done benefits in the early days. And even when we were like a full-time band making a living from it, we did like big benefits for things we were passionate about.
And that's important. That's good. You're giving back.
Yes. And you know what? So we got a few minutes here to the next break. The thing that I feel like I respect so much about what you guys did for so long, and like I said, we haven't even started talking about what you've been doing since. Like I said, we might have to, we'll figure out how to do that. But
part two.
Right. And sorry, folks.
Gigi,
what?
I have a question.
What?
I was, when we were talking on the intro, I was curious what Danbert's influences were when you guys were first starting out, you know, those first high school years.
Ooh,
what kind of music were you guys jigging on, you know?
You're reading my mind, Brad.
Like, you know, when you're like a young teenager, you start listening to albums back in, you know, in the 70s for me. And
right.
And it was like the early mid 70s, and I was, me and my friend.
Any Bee Gees in there?
No, really.
Oh, come on.
So, I'm playing, you
know,
I'm
like older brothers, their album collection. So it was, you know, what we call prog rock, you know, like Genesis and Yes and
okay
and Pink Floyd and yeah. I, you know, as like a 14 year old, I had this idea that you had to be a musical genius to be in a band or even pick up a guitar,
of course.
I kind of fantasized about it, but I never did anything about it. And then like punk rock came along, Sex Pistols and Clash.
Oh, thank God. Right.
I was 15 and suddenly, you know, like there was this local music scene formed, and we'd go to Manchester on the bus to see shows. And, right. And it was like, yeah, just learn three chords. And so, like I said, we had a high school band, and it totally, literally changed my life. And I've been doing it ever since. So
did you guys ever hear of, there was like a little California band back there in the 80s that was really hitting it big over here. You might've heard of them, Van Halen.
Oh yeah,
how'd it hit over there?
Yeah, the so are you there?
Yeah,
yeah,
oh, yes.
Yeah. So
yes.
You know, and there was a little bit, you know, there was, you know, initially punk was like, yeah, everything in the past is like dead to me. Don't even mention it.
Right, right.
As we kind of evolved a little bit, we realized that, oh, yeah, they're actually, you know, because we all grew up on the Beatles and stuff and like, you know, the 60s and the idea of rebellion and protest in music. And then, you know, we start listening to like early Mothers of Invention albums and just weird shit, you know, that had some attitude, whatever that, you know, and we just kind of evolved that way, really. But initially, really, totally, yeah, like Sex Pistols and Clash, and then the whole wave of English punk, British punk bands were formative for me. We were just in the right place at the right time, you know.
Yeah, Van Halen came out there. They're like metal with like David Lee Roth had a little punk attitude with it, so it was kind
yeah,
of
yeah. The guy just died, didn't he? Eddie Van Halen.
Yeah, yeah. That's why I was bringing it up. I was wondering if you ever got
rest
to hear
in peace
his
to
work.
Eddie.
Yeah.
Rest in peace, buddy.
Yeah, brother. So, yeah, that was my couple questions there. Sorry for diving into it.
So now along with that, so obviously, you know, like we kind of hinted at before, I mean, Chumbawamba isn't just a, it's not just a band. It's not, or I'm sorry, it wasn't just a, I mean, this was a, you got, that was a full-blown production every show. That you
guys
did.
Yeah, we like I said, we kind of gradually evolved, and you know, even the high school band. I don't know where it came from initially, but we always thought you know you got to do more on. You know, the stage is such a wonderful platform. You can do more than just play music. So we had these weird theatrical ideas, and that just kind of grew with Chumbawamba. So we had this whole show, and some of the songs had characters, and we'd dress up and have props and whatever, but, you know. And it made it interesting, you know, because if we went to see a show, you know, if the band are just all looking at the shoes, it's kind of boring. The music might be cool, but so we just wanted to use that space and do what, you know, try and do interesting things with it.
And it could have inspired Gore.
The what? Sorry.
I said you could have inspired Gore. You've heard of the band Gore, I'm sure.
I've heard the name. I don't know him.
Oh, no. He's saying Gwar.
Oh, Gwar. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I don't know if we inspired it. I mean, you know, the other bands do it. It's, you know, we played some of those festivals with, like, Insane Clown Posse and Rammstein.
Oh, wow.
Band. And they, you know, not Dude. Really my kind of music, but they had an Blast. Interesting presence on stage, you know.
Cause yeah, they had the theatrics.
Yeah, yeah. And I've always liked that. And it's really interesting.
Primus, too.
Yeah, because, you know, there's four members of Chumbawamba. You know, we were eight people by the end, and four of us now are kind of working in theater, which we never did. We never grew up in that or anything, but. We've kind of gravitated towards that, and it's
out of that. You know what? Unfortunately, we do have to cut to our next network break. Oh boy,
yeah.
We got some stuff to talk about, sir.
I got some questions.
Yeah, F your questions. I got a lot of questions.
I just read some Wikipedia stuff that made me laugh so hard.
Okay.
Well, just make sure you spelled Wikipedia correctly. Yeah, make sure I said it correctly. Actually, you might try to figure that out too. All right, but for real though, ladies and gentlemen, we do have to take a commercial break. And don't forget, folks, we are giving away two. Every time I say two, my headphones come off. Two tickets for the. For the Fringe Fest coming up at the end of the month, and most of your favorite Fringe FM hosts are going to be there, and it's Friday October 30th and Saturday October 31st rather, from noon to midnight both days. Get there while you can status, and you know what you can do is you can go to thefrenchfest.com and get all of your details there, or you don't have to look at any of that, and you can just listen to me tell you right now, Jordan Maxwell is giving a talk. That's it. That's it. So there you go. Get their while you can status. And with that, let's go ahead and move on to the next break. And we'll see you back here in just a few short minutely minutes, my friend. Don't go anywhere.
Yeah, I'll be back. I'll be just...
And we're not very good with our health regimen until it's too late. We don't put oil in the car until the engine blows up. When the body's out of balance, your health is not so good. Give your body some love. Log on to GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. Try our Life Change Tea, which cleanses you from harmful intruders. A clean colon is one of the ways to bring the body in balance. We also carry organic supplements to help you get where you need to go. So do your body a favor. Log on to GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. You can even visit our sales page to save some dough. Does anybody call money dough anymore? Anyway, if you're looking for short, helpful health tips, go to YouTube and punch in Health Matters Now. That's Health Matters Now. So, log on to GetTheTea.com, shop, get balanced, then learn some cool tips at Health Matters Now. You'll be glad you did. That's GetTheTea.com.
From birth, we have been conditioned to conform to what is normal, conditioned to adhere to authority, and conditioned to repeat what has been told to us as truth. I'm Ryan Gable, and here at The Secret Teachings Radio, I've interviewed hundreds of great guests and done extensive unique research into subjects that span from the paranormal and the occult to health, philosophy, and history. I personally have no affiliations or agenda except to use objective critical thinking in my analysis of every subject discussed to empower myself with information and hopefully allow you to do the same. If you want to join me, tune into the Secret Teachings radio broadcast airing live Monday through Friday from midnight to 3 a.m. U.S. Pacific Standard Time on The Fringe FM. For more information, you can visit our website at www.thesecretteachings.info or email me at rdgable@yahoo.com.
Pure Health Defenders, proud sponsor of Shift Happens, producing organic and natural health, wellness, and technology products for people, pets, and plants to thrive alive. Pure Health Defenders, also known as PHD, is powered by C7 Technology, Scalar Energy, Atomic Technology, and fueled by Sea Miracle Superfoods, 118 nutrients of the purest sea vegetables Mother Earth has to offer. Recognized 100% by people, pets, and plants, delivering the value the same. Everybody deserves a PhD. Be smart about it. Come join the healthiest family today.
Kids, don't drink in park. Accidents cause people. This has been a PSA brought to you by your friends at Shift Happens and The Fringe FM.
Ew, yuck, they're unhealthy and gross. Bugs, I hate bugs. We keep a clean home, but occasionally bugs show up. Well, I found something that is tougher than bugs, Orange Guard. From contact, it kills bugs. Plus, Orange Guard kills hidden bugs and keeps new bugs away for weeks. I know. I use Orange Guard. Plus, all of the ingredients of Orange Guard are on the FDA generally regarded as safe list. Orange Guard may be used around food, humans, and pets. It promotes a healthier planet, and here's a bonus. Orange Guard cleans where it's sprayed. Plus, it comes with a 30-day money-back guarantee. Orange Guard.
You can get Orange Guard at Ace Hardware. And listen, folks, Orange Guard is tougher than bugs, and it's safe to use. Go to orangeguard.com. That's orangeguard.com.
KTLK Digital Broadcast. We rock the paranormal talk.
Ladies and gentlemen, we had some, that was just amazing. I wasn't even working for computers for a very long time. Never seen anything like that. Anyway, welcome back to the show. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Shift Happens. I am your host, Gigi. Of course, joining me as per usual is our associate producer, Brad Harris.
Good evening, everybody.
What's happening, Brad?
How's it going over there? Stoked. That was a great first segment. Can't wait to do the famous swan dive with the double backflip and get into some more of this awesomeness. Let's do this.
Swan dive with a double backflip. Didn't I come up with that? Isn't that what I came up with?
I think I threw the double backflip in there.
You might have added that in there. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, you stole my Bruce Lee thing, so it's all good.
Wait, what are you talking about?
Yeah, your hi-ya, that's mine.
Oh, the hi-ya. Mm. No, that's more of a Liu Kang's. Actually, that is more of a... I think you're right, actually. That is what that
Bruce
is.
Bruce Lee.
Yeah, that is Bruce Lee, isn't it?
And, yeah, he had more of a, like, a...
Who turned off all the things? All right.
No. Let's do it.
But yeah, let's get back to this. Lots of questions in the chat room. I will try to get to all of them. Now, so Danbert, I really do want to start here. And by that, I mean the early 80s. Especially when it comes to... I mean, wow, what a crew of people, man. I mean, you, Dunstan, Alice, Harry, everyone, and even Jude later on as well. And you know what's even crazy is for the longest time, I didn't even know that Jude was not on the Anarchy album. I thought that for about 20 years. I thought Jude was on it.
So, like, Maeve, the original bass player, he began to learn trumpet. So he started playing trumpet. And when he no longer could be in the band, we're like, shit, we need someone who can play trumpet because it was so good. So that's how we got Jude. I can't remember how we found her, but we're like, we need a trumpet player. And she just fit right in. So it was great.
And so that, like, was she, Jude, I mean, specifically, was she, you know, was she kind of around the scene for a few years before that? Or was that
around our scene, but she, you know, she, I think, maybe more like a folk scene or a big band kind of scene. And, you know, Leeds, where we all lived, was kind of a melting pot of different musical stuff.
It was, wasn't it? But that whole scene, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but it didn't last as long as, dare I say, it should have. That whole
scene? I don't know. You know, I mean, you know, you're in a city and there's, you know, I mean, a scene kind of happens. And if it's a big city, there's always music. So it just evolves or changes or some new scene comes along. And that was kind of the joy of living in a bigger city because we grew up in smaller towns. So there was always music, you know, and Leeds is not really that known for it. There's certain bands from that area, usually more associated with goth, like The Mission and people like that, and New Model Army just down the road in Bradford. But unlike Manchester, which, you know, had some of the bigger bands. But yeah, so there's always something to tap into. And if you stick around long enough, you just meet new people and you realize, oh, yeah, we've never met, but we have all these things in common, you know.
Yeah, and, you know, here's where I know I like to joke a lot. I like to do that. But let's figure out some stuff here. Well, how about this? Correct me if I'm wrong, because I've kind of heard both sides of the story, specifically when it comes to the popularity that you received in America. And again, like I said, you guys were doing just fine everywhere else. Mm-hmm. But in America, who... I mean, don't get me wrong. Those, you know, Tub Thumping, Amnesia, those two songs from that record, like I said, Anarchy, fantastic. But who didn't want Americans to hear all of your other awesome music? Who, you know what? How about that, Danbert? Who is it?
I don't know.
The guy holding on to all of your recorded,
there's a
badass shows
somewhere
that you've done throughout the 90s and 2000s?
So, you know, our first US tour was in 1990. So we were still, you know, just kind of, you know, we got a letter in the mail saying, oh, do you want to come do a West Coast tour? And we're like, yeah, of course we do. And interestingly, it's like 30 years ago last month. And we wow, started in LA and we went all the way up to Seattle. And, you know, like San Francisco and the kind of punk scene on the West Coast, we were really well received, you know, and we, you know, like somebody posted this in one of the old posters on Instagram, and I'm going to read you the bill. So this was in San Francisco in September 1990. Peter Plate, Neurosis, High Risk Group, Offspring, Cringer, and Chumbawamba. And we were all on the bill in San Francisco 30 years ago. And, you know, we had a great time and we met a lot of great people and realized that there were people, you know, and it's like 6,000 miles from where we grew up, but they have some of the same feelings and attitude.
Right.
And it was a natural home for us, the West Coast, somehow. You know, and we did a bigger tour in like 92, like a six week tour all around the US. But it was still pretty much underground, you know. So people who were there at the time were like, yeah, this is, you know, they knew Chumbawamba. But it was like a real underground thing, really.
Man, yeah, I miss festivals.
Yeah.
Dude.
Yes.
I know, me too. Yeah, we
were so still bad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not, Danbert, are you going to go to the Leeds? There's a Leeds festival, right, that's coming up?
Oh, I don't know. There is, yeah. I mean, we played at them often. You know, we were supposed to go play. They have a big punk festival in England called Rebellion Festival. And we were supposed to play there in early August, but it all got cancelled. So we did this whole online thing, you know, and they've been going like 20 years. But they want us to go next year, so we'll see if it opens up. Yeah.
Because Gigi Queens is going to the Leeds Festival next year, I think.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Or at least that's the plan.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, there's some great things over there. And hopefully that's going to come back, you know, sooner rather than later. But music, yeah, and theater is like the last thing. Indoors is the last thing that's going to come back, unfortunately. Yeah. But,
and okay, so we're about to take a hard left turn here, Danbert. Are you ready?
Okay, yeah.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Hold on, Gigi. Hold on. I want to just mention this.
What?
Hold on, real
want?
Quick.
I'm just kidding, folks. What do you want?
Okay. So, Danbert, Gigi and I like grew up skateboarding, and it's a very, oh, yeah, like, it's like a punk rock goes, yeah, hand, yeah, in hand with skateboarding, it's culture.
Hand in hand, yeah.
And we've never liked cops, right? Because they always, yeah, kicked us out where we were skating.
Well, yeah.
Not to mention arrest.
So funny, I was reading some stuff on the internet, and it popped out. Alice said, "If nothing can change the fact that we like it when cops get killed."
Wow. I didn't think you were going to bring that up.
It's such a bad thing, but it just made me laugh. I don't know why.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, we were like, you know, anarchy, punk rock, and part of that. And from experience, you know, being a teenager and in your 20s, just forever getting pulled over by the cops, you know, yep, just picked on.
That's me.
Yeah, you know, and you're just like a scruffy kid in a car and your car's beat up, and I had this cop and he pulled me over and he says, "Right, look here, look, there's a piece of rust on your car." And it's like on the hood near the windscreen wipers. And he said, "If you hit someone, this piece of jagged metal will cut into them and hurt them." And I'm like, well, the whole front end of the car and the bumper will hit them before the piece of jagged metal, the rusty little bit of the hood at the back of the, you know. But shit, no, he gave me a fine and like, whatever. But, you know, it's funny, you know, and, you know, with what's happened this year with the protests, the Black Lives Matter protests and everything, you know, I'm reading a book now about the history of the cops in America, and it's horrendous. It's just been going on forever. And the only difference is now people film it on the phone. So we actually see it. We actually see the guy kneeling on someone's neck or shooting the guy in the back. And that's I suppose, you know, maybe in the long term, it's a good thing that we see it, because maybe that will mean we'll actually change it, because it's been going on, yeah, for hundreds of years. And, you know, young kids, especially, you know, whether black or white or whatever, cops just want to pick on them. They're easy targets. And you know, like round here, we live in a rural area and there's like two cops, and I know the cops, but one of them will still pull people over because he has his quota to fill every month.
Yeah.
When like 1 mile an hour faster than the speed limit. They're so bored around here, but.
Oh my God.
Cops are, yeah, it's like, it's a huge problem.
Yeah. So, yeah, we got in trouble for that, Alice saying that, you know. And she said, you know, like our manager came in, you know, we were in a hotel in London, said, shit, guys, you know, it's going to be all over the papers tomorrow that you hate cops and you want them to die. Mm-hmm. And we're like, so the next morning we woke up and they had this little shop in the hotel which sold newspapers, and there were nothing in the newspapers because there was like a huge story about, I don't know, Iraq or something. So maybe we were lucky that it didn't like break like that for us, but I don't know.
And then real quick, Gigi, hold on. Another thing she said was like, if you can't afford the records, go steal them from.
Yeah. Yeah. And so that, you know, I stand so by funny. That, you know, we got in huge like, trouble with the record company for that, but
I mean, I feel like Virgin, could they have sued you for that? Or but they still sold the records. They just put them behind the counter.
They're still making shitloads of profit off it. So they might, you know, they'll kick up a fuss, but they're still making a lot of money off it. So, you know, and they, I mean, the real robbers are the corporations.
You no know, doubt. Yeah. Real, we're all 100% agree.
Yeah. So I have no regrets about, you know, if you have no money, then you need to food, or you want some joy in your life from some music, then yeah, why not?
Dude, that's, yeah. I love like the essence. I just love that so much.
Yes, me too. And we still have a whole hour left. Listen, Danbert, if you got to go at any time, you're more than welcome. But man, I've got to ask though, because I think, like I mentioned before, good Lord, talk about one human being living life to the fullest. I'm not sure if you realize who I'm talking about yet.
I don't know.
No, that's you. That's you that I'm talking about. And also not to, but I mean, just to be very honest, everyone, Harry, Boff, everyone, the whole crew, you guys, you know, like I said, just, I've never seen a level of cooperation. Not to mention, actually, you know what? I'm not going to mention that. but anyway, my point is, man, so with all of that, and I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong, but I feel like that whole, and I know you were only there until 2004, and then Going was fantastic. I know you had some other roles in the back. Round. Hopefully we can discuss that a little bit more. But again, just kind of to my dumb American audience, I don't mean to call my American audience dumb, because I'm dumb too, because I live here. But what's going on? Do you guys like you or Jude or Dunstan or Harry or any, like, do you guys, you know, like, are you guys kind of over it? Like, you guys kind of, you're doing your own thing now?
No, I mean, you know, so, no. So, you know, for me, it was 22 years of my life, from being age 20 to early 40s. And, you know, like I said, I kept a list of all the shows, and we did over, I don't know, 1,200 shows in that time, in 22 years. And if you think a show is like a day of your life, that's over 4 years of my life. Basically, and the whole history of it carries on. You know, people still want to hear about it, or they just discover the fact that we had like 11 studio albums and not just the big one that people know. And you know, so we're all still in touch. I mean, you know, obviously I'm like 6,000 miles away. Most of the other guys still live in Leeds, but whenever I go back to England, I end up staying with them and hanging out and everything. And you know, there's still like business things that come up, and someone wants to re-release the albums on vinyl, so we got to talk about it and all that kind of thing. And Dunstan, he did this thing about, when he stopped in Chumbawamba in 2004 as well, me, Alice and Dunstan, yeah. His partner was a documentary filmmaker, so he kind of ended up being her assistant.
Yeah, but he didn't even say a word about that until like 4 years ago.
And so, you know, he ended up making a film about Sham 69, an English punk band who went to China, because his partner was too busy. So he says, oh, I'll do it. And he was quite, you know, he got a little bit of, like, you know, respect, or people heard about it. And then he made another one, and then he said, I should make one about Chumbawamba. And he did this, what do they call it, Kickstarter. And he raised...
Yes, he did the Kickstarter five or six... Listen, Dan, Bert,
okay, I gotta finish,
Dan Bert.
I gotta
oh, okay. Go well, ahead. Go ahead.
So, you
go
know,
ahead.
And I went over to England, and we're all in a room together, and he's interviewing us. And somebody said, isn't this super weird? Because you watch documentaries about bands, and they all hate each other. And, like, Dunstan's like, yeah, I can't, it's very difficult to make this film interesting because there's no, like, huge drama. I mean, we had fights on tour and everything, but we were always remained friends.
Well,
and
so
still
does
are.
Anybody, right?
Yeah, yeah. And so he still hadn't brought the film out, and he can't find, like, a narrative thread to make it interesting, because, you know, most documentaries are like reality TV. They exaggerate everything, and we were never really like that. I mean, we have some interesting stories, but we were never at each other's throats, which is the picture you get of most kind of rock bands. You know, somebody leaves and they hate each other and they don't talk to each other for like 10 years and all that business. But we were genuinely, you know, we worked as a cooperative. And, you know, if you were on the album and you went on tour, then you got an equal share. And I think because we did that throughout, it meant there was no like huge arguments about money, because we just shared it. You know, if you were part of the team, then you got an equal share, and that to us seemed really sensible. And maybe, you know, because we started, you know, we all squatted in a house together, we had some kind of pre-preparation for when we were like on tour the whole time. We were each other's company and each other's, you know, weaknesses and strengths and weird personality traits and everything else.
Okay, we just have a comment from the chat room very specifically saying, call the cops where I live to help. They never get here. Good luck to you, Mike. I don't know what to do about that. Godspeed. But thanks for listening to the show. Yeah, that's all I had. But man, so... Here's the other thing, though. So, how much longer do we have? Oh, we've got a whole nother hour. But you know what really sucks, Danbert?
What?
I have to take a commercial break.
Okay.
So, let's go ahead and do that. And when we get back, let's figure some shift out. No pun. Well, actually, that pun was intended. Ladies and gentlemen, you are listening. I think. Good Lord, Joe.
I have to say, Shift Happens is a really clever name. I like it.
Well, you know what? That was Cortana, my original co-host. And yeah. That all goes out to Cortana. You can thank her for
I'd
that.
I'd wear the t-shirt, man.
And, by the way, do you want... I don't care if you want a t-shirt. I'm sending you one anyway. I don't know where your address is, but I'm just going to send it in some sort of direction. I'm just going to hope.
Okay, I'll tell you later.
Yeah.
Get this man a t-shirt. Pronto.
Well, I'm trying. What do you want me to do?
Brad. Where's Brad at?
Guess where Brad is.
I don't
Not
know.
Here. but that's all right. Hey, listen, folks, thanks for tuning in so far, and we've got a whole nother hour. And don't forget, we are giving away two free tickets to the Fringe Fest. If you want to know any information about that, go to www.thefringefest.com, and all the information is over there. And, I'll just leave it at that. All right, and all right, folks, we'll see in just a couple of short, minutely minutes right back here on the Fringe FM. Don't go anywhere.
Tired of talking about the weather? No, Shift. Well, Shift Happens is here to fulfill your desires. As you reach that point in life where you crave tantalizing conversation about reality, ufology, the occult, and the conspiracies within, while simultaneously finding yourself desperately in need of your very own theme music, which we've got plenty of that too. So be sure to tune in to Shift Happens every Friday night from 7 to 9 Pacific, right here on The Fringe FM. Because the weather sucks, and you need some theme music.
Ever seen an extraterrestrial? It can be hard to believe they exist unless you've seen one for yourself. What if I told you I've seen them my whole life, but have never had a witness who shared the encounter with me? Now, what if I told you I saw four of them, two with blue skin, and there are over 20 witnesses to this CE5 event? My new book, The Blue Beings, Visitation at the UFO Conference, documents actual accounts from real witnesses, many of which have gone on record to attest to this otherworldly reality. Be a part of a quantum paradigm shift that is taking place right now. Go to johnpolkmedia.com to get your copy of The Blue Beings, Visitation at the UFO Conference, on sale right now at johnpolkmedia.com. That's johnpolkmedia.com.
This is Ronnie LeBlanc, author of Monsterland, Encounters with UFOs, Bigfoot, and Orange Orbs, and you're listening to Shift Happens on KTLK, The Fringe FM.
KTLK Digital Broadcast. We rock the paranormal talk.
Welcome back
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. You know, let me just say one thing, folks. It's amazing how sometimes there's just not simply enough hours in one day. Yeah, anybody feel me on that? Let me know in the chat room. Speaking of which, we do have a couple of chat rooms over here at the Fringe FM. First of which is over at Spreaker. The quickest way to get there is go to shifthappensradio.com. Right there on the homepage is the current episode player. And that's it. There you go. Now, real quick, before we get back to the boogie, of course, you know what? We'll save that for a little bit. In the meantime, let's go ahead and check in with our associate producer, Brad Harris. What's happening, Brad? He's there somewhere, folks. He's there. And, but you know what? That's right. So real quick, you know what? Let's just get on with this. So Danbert, now real quick, before we, you know, take a stroll back into memory lane, let's catch everybody up with what you're doing now, because, listen, man, you sent me the, you know, I got the new double album, which also came with the music videos, and I've got to say, you can't just call something like that a... That's not an album. It's not just a record. That's a full-blown, like, production. I just enjoyed that so much. So real quick, before we get into anything else... Let's let everybody know where they can catch your latest double record over there.
So I have albums that I've done after Chumbawamba, and they're all at Bandcamp. Danbert Nobacon, and the band is kind of called Axis of Defense. So I think it's Danbert Nobacon, Axis, the Bandcamp. And yeah, it's interesting because, you know, when Chumbawamba was done, I thought, right, I'm going to write both. You know, because when Chumbawamba was done for me in 2004, I'd been writing like a blog page, they didn't call them blogs back then, on the Chumbawamba website. And it was all about what had happened since 9/11 and the war on terror and the war on our individual, you know, on our freedoms, basically, in Britain. I was still living in England. And then an old friend said, oh, you should come play a solo show. So I did. And you know, I was trying to write like a current affairs book about all the shit that was upshift that was going on.
Glad you got that. Good for you.
And it's just like quicksand because it changes every day. And so all that kind of writing went into a solo album that, well, it was a collaborative album that came out in 2007 called Library for the World. And it's kind of like a document of the George W. Bush, Tony Blair years. Like, you know, just go to war and suck all the money from the taxpayer into the war machine. And I kind of realized, look, you know, I'm always going to write songs and bits of theater about what's going on, and you know, fiction and whatever else, political essays. So you know, I have like three albums that I've done since Chumbawamba. Is that right? Three. You know, and honestly, I have twins who are 20 now. So
I think it's more than that. I think it's more than that, isn't it? Well, it I mean, be, you, yeah. you performed at some pretty prolific performances since then, I guess we could say.
Yeah, yeah. And so I love being on stage, even if there's only like 10 people there. So this COVID thing is like kind of crazy. It's making me a little bit crazy because I can't be live in front of people. And I don't know why, if it's a genetic thing, why I do that. Why it makes, you know, it just makes me feel good. It's like going for a run or whatever, whatever makes you feel good. Being on stage is like an adrenaline rush. And
it really is.
Yeah. So I, you know, living out here, I live in rural Washington, and interestingly, there's a lot of musicians and usually places, you know, bars and restaurants where you can play and little festivals. And then I go to Seattle and Portland. But all that, you know, we haven't been able to do that this year. But yeah, so the new record, which, like, you know, it's all the stuff I've written since Trump got elected. And I thought, right, I want to put this album out in the election year 2020, and got it all organized, recorded it. And we were done recording in February and mixing, luckily, on one level. Because I don't know what would have happened if we'd have gone into March and the shutdown and everything. So yeah. And we, like I said, we had tours set up, but they fell apart. But it's just, I have this thing where I need to express, you know, something about what's going on. So the record was done before the pandemic and before the protests. And the shit has happened since, you know, and before. Well, I mean,
that's even crazier. What?
Yeah, the record kind of acknowledges, you know, it's a whole theatrical thing. I thought, right, well, shit, I don't want to just make a record shift. I don't want to make a record that.
Listen, dude, you are the one guest that is allowed to say whatever the fudge circle you want. Yes.
So I don't just want to make a record that is just, you know, and the election comes and then, you know, Trump gets kicked out and it's done, it's history. So there's all these kind of theatrical, some of them fictional themes along, you know, there's all these theater bits and huge, you know, big songs with like a full band on there. And it's as if some like government agents in like 5 years time have found this cache of audio files and they've been assigned to like decipher it. And because they think there's terrorists at work, you know, left-wing terrorists, when we know the opposite is all the domestic terrorists are right-wing fascists, pretty much. But it's just the way that, you know, government, like Trump, you know, I mean, the idea that Trump and his attorney general are proclaiming that like Seattle and Portland are on fire the whole time and they're anarchist jurisdictions. I mean, it's insanity, really, that he can even still try and push that myth. And some people believe it, you know, some of his right-wing base, but it really doesn't hold up when you look at the protests. I mean, of course, people throw rocks and occasionally set fire to things, but it's not like a constant thing. It's just an expression of outrage, like we were talking about earlier, the police of hundreds of years of oppression.
It's just nature.
For people of color and black people and even poor white people. So, and most of the protests are peaceful until the right wingers come along, you know, armed to the teeth, you know, in military combat gear and stir shit up, or the cops purposely stir shit up. So the record kind of, you know, takes all that into account, what's been going down, you know, the last few years in America. And it's the record's called Mesmerica Expect a Circus.
Yes, and in fact, like, aren't most of the songs called that? And then there's like number six at the end. Anyway, what I'm trying to say is, dude, that album that you sent me, that you guys can go buy right now from danbertnobacon.com.
Yeah, if you go to the website, there's a link straight to it.
Yeah, it's right there. And not only do you get all, like you said, it's a double album. And by double album, I'm talking, like, what is it, 25, 28 27 songs.
Yeah, and it's like that. You know, I didn't intend it to be a double album, but
well, of course you didn't. Of course you didn't. You were just doing what you were doing.
Yeah, and I always try and put a CD out. You know, I do things digitally, but I try and put a CD out. You know, a limited edition, so that there's a physical copy of it. And we realized it wouldn't fit on one CD. So it's like 84 minutes. And I think you can get away with 80 minutes on one CD, but it's a bit dodgy, you know. So I thought, okay, we'll do two CDs. And then someone said, oh, you should put it on vinyl, but it'd be like three vinyl albums. And I just don't have the budget to you know, I inquired about putting out three vinyl albums. You know, the people who do the CDs, they do vinyl. And it's like, oh, my goodness, no, it's going to cost you like an arm and a leg to do a triple album.
Yeah, and listen, you know what? So we have some of the funniest people that hang out in our chat rooms, and I can't always tell if they're serious or not. Okay, so play a song. What do you want to play? I don't know. Are you listening to the show? Anyway. But hey, if you, so we're going to be here for another, for those of you listening, we got about 40 more minutes, right? Or, I mean, can you hang out for 40 more minutes?
Oh yeah, I can. Yeah.
All right. Fantastic. Okay, so with that said, folks, do you want me to play a song? What do you want me to play? I'll play, I'll pay Mary Had a Little Lamb. Is that what you want? Somebody let me know.
Mm-hmm.
All right, there you go. Oh, not you, Damper. I'm talking to our crazy audience that we deal with every Friday. Okay, so now, so we've got, like I said, we got a little bit of time left. So now we have a new question. Is there a bong song? Of course there is. Do I have a bong song? I don't think so. I hope I did. Anyway, here's the thing though, Dan. I think there's a lot of people that, for whatever reason or another, they just, you know, they just happen to grow up in America, right? Some people grow up in Europe, blah, mm-hmm. blah, blah. And you, like I said before, you guys have been crushing it, except Americans have not been aware of that. We have not been made aware of that. I mean, we did, you know, we had that one song, like I said. but man, your story is very, I would just love to do a part two. And not to mention, like I told you before we did the show, we probably would be talking about Chumbawamba a little bit.
Yeah.
But I would love to talk about what you've been doing since Chumbawamba. Hence, a part two. So, yeah. And again, that's up to you. And I got to say, man, this has been so much fun. Not to mention, we still have 37 minutes. So, yeah, I don't know. You know what? Listen, folks, I do see both of the chat rooms. I'm not going to lie to any of you. I haven't read a single word that anyone has said this whole time. I know that's kind of stupid to say, but I'm just being honest. Usually I see what's going on, but you know what? Danbert's here. I'm just talking to him. So there you go. Now, if you really want to get a hold of me, just message me on Twitter. That's it. That's all you got to do. That's all you got to do. So now, Danbert, I mean, what do you think? What are we gonna do? Kind of crazy times, right? And you've been, correct me if I'm wrong, but like pretty much most of your life, you and your friends and your whole crew, you guys have just been, you guys killed it. And
what's happening now reminds me very much of what is happening, what happened when Chumbawamba first kind of started in the early 80s. So in Britain, we had Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan in America. You know, and we were on the demonstration in London when Ronald Reagan hung out with the Queen and went to the America. We were outside the US Embassy. And what was happening then was kind of the start of, you know, what you would probably call neoliberalism, where, you know, corporations and rich people and politicians kind of all clubbed together to think, look, you know, really we should just kind of rip everybody off and don't give a crap about ordinary working people. And there was a recession in the 1980s, and Margaret Thatcher basically attacked the whole working class whenever she could. And the same in America, you know, Ronald Reagan. And what's happening now is like that on steroids, you know, the GOP, the Republicans, and some of the corporate Democrats as well. They just want to take the money. And of course, you know, Trump on steroids, GOP, and he's actually on steroids on top of that. So it's like, you know, it's like, and you know, we went and played, Chumbawamba played around Europe, and we were very well received in Germany. And at the time it was West Germany before the fall of the Berlin Wall. And we played some benefits, and they were anti-fascist benefits. And these were kids whose parents and grandparents had been Nazis, you know, during World War II. And, you know, fought for Hitler, but the youth at that time in the 80s in Europe were in left-wing and anarchist punk circles, were very anti-fascist, and it was a huge lesson to us. Britain was in World War II, you know, fight, you know, our grandparents and parents were fighting the Nazis, and it all kind of made sense that fascism doesn't just go away because the government say, no, we're super democratic and blah, blah, blah. It's always kind of lurking in the background. And it seems now in America and other countries around the world, it's making a comeback. And, you know, we have this election in like less than 3 weeks. You know, and Trump's talking about arresting his opponents, and sending like armed militias to voting stations, and it is fascist tactics, whether you want to call it full blown fascism, but that's how Hitler started. You know, Hitler started in the late 20s and early 30s and didn't kind of rise to full power until, you know, 1939 or whatever, when World War II started. So it's like a real, you know, it's having lived through the whole Thatcher Reagan thing, and then, you know, Bill Clinton pretending, oh yeah, we're kind of nicey nicey, but we're still going to rip you off. It's just like, shit, yeah, we have to get our act together and vote against fascism. And then if Joe Biden gets in, it's like, yeah, he's another neoliberal fight from day one. But yeah, very insane times we're living in.
Truer words have never been spoken, my friend. And just good luck to all of us. How about that? Can we do that? Is that okay to say?
That's it, yeah. That'll sum it up.
Yeah.
See, what I think is happened, you know, like the Republicans in particular, and some corporate Democrats, they've just basically given up on the idea of actually pretending that they're elected, that they're supposed to help people.
Yeah.
And they're just like, right, you know, climate change is happening. You know, and they, so for instance, okay, so during George W. Bush, Republicans, they accepted that climate change was real, but they didn't want to do anything about it, but at least they accepted it. you know, and then the Tea Party came along, and Citizens United ruling by the Supreme Court, and it suddenly, you know, no limit on big money in elections. And it's like they adopted this, you know, and they still know that climate change is real, but they've decided that, right, we're just going to take what we can get and hole up, you know, when it comes to it, you know, hunker down in their mansions and bunkers or whatever the hell it is. And they think that the army and the police will be on their side, and to hell with everyone else. And that has been the story of, you know, since Trump got elected, certainly. He gives no regard for ordinary people, whatever he pretends, you know, when he pretended in 2016, oh, you know, I'm going to, you know, I'm for the working person and blah, blah, blah. And it's, I'm going to drain the swamp. And he is the swamp, basically. on steroids.
He's like a whole nother swamp.
A whole nother swamp.
On top of the swamp.
So I do hope we get rid of him in November. Who knows what's going to happen with his supporters, because they're not going to be happy if, you know. I mean, if there was a fair election, he is absolute toast, but I don't think there'll be a fair election, and that's kind of the worry.
Yeah, that's a shift has just sketchy written all over it to me.
Yeah. So we'll see very soon. So if we do a part two, we can assess the damage.
Yeah, yeah. And I really would like to do that, man. You know, like I said, it don't get me wrong, the French FM has been the best fucking thing that's ever happened to me in the last, like, fucking 5 years. But I can't cuss and express myself properly. So that's why we've done this other show on Twitch. And not to, just to put this in perspective, Danbert, so we have some pretty cool features on Twitch, like one of which is so we have a clip of Alex Jones saying, "I'll eat your ass," right?
Mm-hmm.
And anyone in the audience can trigger that sound clip to play over the show. I know it's kind of silly, but everybody has fun. And don't get me wrong, we still get into deep shit. Mm-hmm. Or maybe we don't. Maybe we talk about, you know, what kind of strings you use on your Gibson. You know, whatever. It's just...
Yeah, yeah. No, and that's cool, too. You know, yeah. I do a local radio show here. Just like... Well, usually I do it like two or three times a month. I don't quite do it every week, but lately I've been doing it every week because I'm on lockdown pretty much. And it, you know, it is comedy, basically. So it's just like, you know, what's going on in the local, you know, and then we play music and there's like four characters. So it's like talk radio, but I do all the voices. So it's kind of like, it's kind of fun for me to do, and people find it funny. But with everything that's going on, I can't not comment on what's happening. So lately it's become, I still try and retain some just everyday comedy, but I can't not talk about what's going on as well. So I try and combine the two. And I don't know if that works all the time, but sometimes, you know.
Sometimes honestly, man, I think it works, man. Listen, I took a... what can I describe as a semi-heroic dose of edibles? And then I listened to that whole record. Damn. That's not just, you know, like I said earlier, that's not a record. That's not an album. That's a production. This is a whole,
yeah, well,
you guys are like, on some other shit. You know what I'm saying?
It's like the whole Chumbawamba thing with the theater on stage. It's like trying to put that on a record. How do you convey that on a record? You know, I mean, you can have songs, which is great, but then how do you, you know, and, you know, so I listen to like spoken word records or whatever, or comedy records, or, and I actually Well, I'm not doing it at the moment, but I teach theater in the local high school.
So, really?
You know, yeah. And I've done it for like 7 years.
What?
And we had a local thing. You know, whoever built the school, they didn't think about putting a performance space in
there.
So we
had that explains quite a lot as to why I can't find very much information about you over the last 7 years.
Yeah. And, the local newspaper, we still have a local newspaper, and they always put stuff in if there's a music or a CD or we're doing some theatre production. And I just wanted to try and, because Kira, who is the singer, the other singer on the record, we met doing community theatre in Twisp here in Washington. She grew up here. And I wanted, and she's a great actor. And she'd never, sung on stage or in a band. And after a drunken conversation, she says, oh, I'll come be your backup singer. And we tried it, and it worked out really well. And I thought, we've got to use, her theatrical talent and mine and try and put that on a record and have a whole band on there as well. But just try and broaden the horizons of what an album could, if it was in the 70s, they'd call it a concept album, I guess. But it kind of reflects what I do on my radio show, but it also, and what I've done with Chumbawamba and other kind of collaborative music albums, but I just wanted to try and translate that theatrical element to a record.
Wow. Okay. We just blew right past our commercial break, and let's just keep going. Yeah. How about that? Let's just keep going. Hey, if anybody wants to be mad at me, feel free to direct all of your, where to contact me. Just call me. Let me know what's going on. So here. Again, this is like a 2 or 3 part series. Let's try to figure out what we can here. Like I said before, what you guys were doing back in the early 90s, even late 80s, what have you, nobody was paying you to say that. You know what I mean? Like, that was you guys. And by you guys, I mean, 8 of you. Can you think of another group of 8 people who actually all... Don't get me wrong. I'm sure you guys disagreed on all kinds of shift.
Oh, yeah, we did. We did.
Yes, of course. Man, I feel like, I feel like it's time for you guys to come out again. And just like, Bailey said on, which by the way, I've got to say, that last DVD that you guys did, Going, right?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God. Not to mention your introduction. Wow. Mm-hmm. Amazing. Are you kidding me? I can never write that. But also, just like Bailey said, he was like, listen, you guys shouldn't break up.
I know. That was 2012, and that was the 30th anniversary, because the first show was in 1982. So I guess in a couple of years, it's 40 years, which is frightening. I don't know if we'll do anything. We probably won't. But I did realize the other day, oh, shit, that's coming up.
Listen, you can say whatever you want, sir. If anybody wants to get mad, they can get mad at me. They can get mad at me, all right?
You can say all the other ones, but for shift, you
yeah, so on the new record... because being in radio, I'm aware of, what's not, and there are some swear words on it, SH1T. I mean, to me, that's not a swear word.
But they're not just swear words. They're, meaningful words that just so happen to be swear words. Do you understand? Like,
yeah. So I, you know, I like to invent words. So I, you know, and they're on the record. They're in songs, and one is Mother Gutting, you know, which is kind of an evocative image of what, you know, is happening to the planet by corporations. And the other's like Father Mucking. You know, and obviously they sound like, you know, the top swear word you can use on radio, but they're not actually swear words because I've kind of used the same sounds but altered the spelling. So I kind of like doing that. I like playing around with that. But.
Well, ironically, people are doing it because they have to nowadays.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
How you can't say that word. Only Dan is allowed to say that word, please.
yeah, I can't say it on my radio show. So
wait, what? You can't say it on your own radio show?
Yeah.
Well, who am I to talk? I can't say it on my own show either. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I guess we're right on the same page.
You know.
but hey, okay, listen, folks, in both of the chat rooms, I'm not going to lie to any of you. I have not been looking at either of them this whole entire time. I'm sorry, but I'm having too much fun talking to Danbert and Hal and Brad when he's here sometimes. And this has just been awesome. And okay, you know what? This is a great question. Coming in from the audience, coming in from IPD, we all know him as Idea Petri Dish, and he asks, Fatter Mucker, with a question mark at the end.
Father Mucker, yeah.
Father Mucker.
Am I the only one that doesn't know what the fudge sickle
what the muck that is?
Yeah.
Well, you know, language, you know, ordinary people... Throughout history, have used swear words, and language evolves and morphs and everything else. But you know, the mother F word. I've always thought, well, why ain't there a word that talks about the guy, the man, in the same derogatory way? You know, it's the worst thing you can say.
it actually sounds better.
Yeah, I don't know if I've got there. You know, maybe it's a work in progress, but, you know, and you want it to be on the radio as well. So Father Mucker rhymes with Mother Gutting, rhymes with, you know, the one you can't say. So I'm just kind of playing around with the language. You know, and I think, you know, like, you know, if you read books, if you read, you know, Shakespeare did it. He made words up. I think he made up the word bedroom, if you can believe that, which we all use, but he made it up. It didn't exist. Put stuff in his
brilliant.
Book. You know, and
okay.
You know, yeah, not that any of my made up words right. will make it after I'm dead. I don't think people are gonna say it. But you never know.
That reminds me of the book 1984, The Doublespeak.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And that is so... Just, I mean, you know, the fact that we have a president who basically pretty much made his name on a reality TV show. So, and he, you know, and everything he says is like doublespeak, Orwell speak, pretty much. And he, I think even Orwell would be probably shocked by the way language, you know, by the way he just is a pathological liar, you know.
Yeah, he's like the quintessential corporate pig from the Pink Floyd music videos. Yes. It's like they predicted it. I love Pink Floyd, so it's like it just makes perfect sense. That's what it is. That's what it is, you know?
Especially if you grew up where mushrooms grow naturally. Yes, that's... well, you know what? We'll just leave that conversation there. Oh, thank God I'm just now seeing all the chat messages. Listen, folks, sorry if I didn't see it before. I'm just now seeing them. Okay. Anyway, but hey, Danbert, I do got to ask you one thing, though.
Okay.
And I think I actually kind of asked you this earlier. I started to ask you this earlier, okay? You ready?
Okay.
Are you ready? All right, here we go. So as someone who, I'm not even like trying to exaggerate, like you have literally lived your life to the fullest. Not only you, your whole crew, the whole, and we talked, you know what I'm saying? So what do you do now? Like man, you guys crushed it for so long. And, you know, again, like I said, your new double album is such a breath of fresh, dare I say, subtly psychedelic air. And, and very, is she here? Do you, does she want to come on the show? Does she have anything to say?
She's not here, no.
Okay. She's
just like down the road, but, it's funny. We did, you know, we've done some online things, performances, and we hadn't done one for like about 2 months. And last night we did one on my porch. And I'm going to edit it. You know, it's not gone out yet, but, so me and Kira and Anna, the fiddle player, we did a little, like a half an hour set of songs from the record. And it'll come out in November in Philadelphia, where we were supposed to play punknews.org. They do like a summer festival, and we were supposed to play at it in August, and we couldn't do it. They couldn't do it. And so he's doing it online, but it's coming out in November. So, but yeah, Kira's down the road. So, yeah. That's interesting. I mean, I like that. And it's easy for me to forget, especially being here on lockdown and not being able to do the thing that I love most, which is performing in front of an audience.
Yes.
I lose track of the fact that I have done all the, or in Chumbawamba did all these things. And I sincerely hope we can get back to, you know, just hanging out in a bar or playing music in a bar or what comedy in a bar or whatever it is, where we can just, you know, have fun and do it like we've always done it. And suddenly we have this pandemic, which throws things into like what we previously thought was like, you know, what you watch on Netflix, sci-fi, but it's real, it's happening, and we're living through it, and it's crazy. And, you know, I mean, I have.
What about the drive-in shows?
Wait, yeah,
hold we haven't on. Done
but hold have y'all done any?
No, I think that is a way to go.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, go ahead, Hal.
Yeah. So, you know, there's something very human about people getting together and having fun and having music and theater and entertainment and saying whatever they want to say. And I hope we do. I do hope we get back to that soon, but we'll see. That'd be a bit longer than we all hope.
Yeah, and look, and here comes J-Ron. Let's see what he has to say. You know, again, like as Queen, I do see you saying a lot of things in there. But man, there's a lot of people in the chat room. Kind of impossible to keep up with what's happening here. So with that, we got about 12 minutes. Now, like I did mention earlier, there is just simply no way to encapsulate the life that you have lived. Certainly not in 2 hours. So, not to mention, like, how about that? I don't know. What do you think, Danbert? Maybe, next month, December, maybe January.
Yeah. I think, I don't think we're going anywhere fast with what's happening in the world. So I do have time, and I enjoy, talking on a podcast or radio. And so, yeah.
All right. Fantastic. And
there it is.
And that was it. You're right, Hal. That was it. We're done. Oh my God. I'm not gonna lie. This is like the longest show I've ever. I mean, all of my shows are 2 hours long, but this one seems a lot longer. But anyway, with that said, hey,
Dan, because we skipped the last commercial break.
yeah, and even if I didn't do that, anyway. Listen, Danbert, thank you so much for coming out tonight, and listen, sir, it's been a pleasure to talk to you, and I really do hope to, and I know my our listeners do too. In fact, they're already asking me about it, so maybe we can figure that out, or if not, it's all good. But either way, Danbert Nobacon, God bless you. That new double record you put out is just such a, like I said, you can't, it's uncategorizable. You can't really put a label on that. And that's why I love it so much. And so hopefully we'll talk to you soon. And real quick, Danbert, is there any, social media links, websites, where can everybody keep up that is?
Yeah, well, thanks so much for inviting me and having me on the show. I totally appreciate it. And the best place is danbertnobacon.com, because I have all these things I'm doing, and I kind of, most of them, I put them on the website at some point. So there's links to the Bandcamp and everything. So the records and the stuff that doesn't, like theater doesn't really, it's like it lasts for a short period of time when you do it live and then it's gone. So I try and, preserve it a little bit on the website, and there's links to the whole Chumbawamba history and everything. I'm very proud, it's amazing. You talk about the life I've lived, and we all are. We're very proud of what we did, and at the time we were just doing it. But when you look back on it, it kind of amazes me sometimes, and so it's good to talk about it, thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you so much. Man, okay. I'm just, like I said before, listen, sorry guys, wasn't looking at the chat room. I'm having too much fun talking to Danbert here. I do see the questions though, and don't get me wrong, I will copy and paste all these questions, and perhaps sometime we can have Danbert back on the show sometime. And listen, folks, we didn't even touch the tip of the iceberg. That was the tip of the iceberg as far as what Danbert has done and his involvement with all these different projects over the years. So anyway, again, Danbert, thank you so much for coming on. And guess what? I'm ending the show a little bit early. Never saw that coming, did you? All right, so with that, that's right. Okay, actually, you know what? Well, Danbert, if you got other shift to do, you're more than welcome to go away. I just have to sit here and give away a couple of tickets. But If you feel like hanging out in about 10 minutes, I got something cool for you. But if not,
okay, cool.
I'll just email you in a couple of weeks. How about that?
Yeah.
All right.
Well, thanks, guys. Thanks, Sean. Thanks, Brad. And Gigi, of course. And yeah, cool.
All right. Thank you so much, man. And yeah, we'll talk to you sooner than later, my friend.
Okay.
All right. Cheers to you, man.
Yeah. Thanks. See ya.
And with that, ladies and gentlemen, unfortunately, I went back to edit this episode because there was some dead space in the after this point in the show, or dead air, rather. And long story short, I ended up just chopping off the last 15 minutes of the episode, and it's gone forever. So now... But you're not missing out on anything. We basically just did nothing for like 10 minutes and I was just being dumb. So it's all, that was pretty much the whole episode right there, folks. So once again, I would like to thank Danbert Nobacon for coming on the show. Absolutely, just what an awesome dude and what an epic career those guys had. And with that... Ladies and gentlemen, this has been Shift Happens here for The Fringe FM. The show has been hosted and produced by yours truly, Gigi. You can follow me on Twitter over at GigiRabbit1. And make sure to follow the show as well over at Shift Happens Pod. Associate producer is Brad Harris. You can follow him on Twitter over there at ADSBradHarris. And even Halfry's on Twitter now. You can follow him over at Halfry. That's H-A-L-F-R-Y. Special shout out to Eric Awakening Man, our roaming reporter, as well as Dennis Koch for all of the promotional goodness that he does. And as always, all blames and faults go to Fran. That's right. Hashtag Fran's fault. All right, folks, thanks for tuning in. Don't go too far, though, because coming up next right here on The Fringe FM is Lighting the Void with Joe Roop. All right, folks, have a great rest of your weekend, and we'll see you very much sooner than later. Cheers to you.